Vanilla, a tropical crop that majorly loves the soils of Africa. Used majorly in the beverage industry, the crop grows well in loose soils with high organic matter. In Uganda, vanilla is mainly grown in the districts of Mukono, Kayunga, and Bundibugyo. Vanilla grows as a vine climbing up an existing tree. Vanilla grows best in a hot and humid climate from sea level to an elevation of 1,500 meters. It is said to have been introduced to Mukono by tycoon Aga Sekalala Sr., who was giving planting materials to farmers free. His aim was to popularize the crop.
In the 1990s,
more farmers embraced vanilla. Many thought it was a better alternative to coffee, whose prices had taken a tumble at the time. Others opted for vanilla because of the banana bacterial wilt, which had decimated hundreds of plantations. From then, vanilla became the crop of choice for the biggest percentage of Mukono's farming community, a crop where they earned much of their revenue until 2005. In 2003, something very dramatic happened here. The price of this crop, the vanilla crop, rose dramatically from 5,000 shillings a kilo to 150,000 shillings, or the equivalent of $70. People became rich overnight. Communities here became more prosperous just by selling a few quantities of this crop. But then 2 years later, prices fell dramatically to as low as 1,000 shillings a kilo, crushing the hopes and aspirations of the vanilla growing communities here. I'm Ronald Kato on this edition of The Big Issue. I'm in Mukono District to examine how the communities have found recovery from the vanilla bubble of 2004.
So the vanilla bubble came blown by the wind into Uganda from countries in the Indian Ocean like Madagascar, where vanilla is domainly housed and grown. Something happened to their supply side, so the wind blew the benefit of their disadvantage into a benefit to us. But we should not have planned our long-term survival strategies on a bubble. But we should have grabbed the bubble and say, let it help me as it does while it lasts. So I am very sure that the mistake that was made by the business people was to think that was a permanent change. And so they encouraged farmers. Some farmers cut their coffee, cut their bananas, thinking this is the way to go. So some of the business people encouraged the farmers to actually make these permanent changes for their business case, and the farmers got it wrong.
The kind of traffic that plied the bumpy and dusty Karosi Nyenga Road now is a far cry from what used to drive along this Maram Road 10 years ago. Motorcycles and saloon cars belonging to local businessmen have now replaced the large trucks that used to drive here to collect vanilla. Mpata sub-county is one of the areas worst affected by the fall in prices of vanilla, and I'm headed there to see how the farmers have been adjusting. In the home of Mr. Peter Sekabira, this Jatropha cactus tree is the only living sign vanilla existed here. The trees, locally known as kirowa, are used as support plants for vanilla vines. Before 2005, Sekabira was one of the biggest vanilla farmers in Pata sub-county. He commanded a lot of respect as a zone leader responsible for supervising farmers in three parishes. All that, however, came to a painful stop in 2005 when vanilla prices took a terrible tumble. That changed so many things here. The 62-year-old's life took a negative turn. Almost everything has been falling apart. In 2004, Sekabira got 20 million shillings after selling just over 50 kilograms of vanilla. As a peasant who had struggled his entire life to break free from poverty, it was good money. His immediate plan was to embark on poultry farming as a way to diversify his vanilla-dependent economy. These structures were meant to house 10,000 birds. It was an ambitious project, one that would grow into tens of millions of shillings as vanilla prices continued to soar. But that project was never to take off, as vanilla prices took a fall just months later. The rooms that were supposed to house chicken are now wasting away. For Sekabira, it is dreams and prospects of a better future that met a ruthless end.
The fall of the price from 150,000 shillings to 1,000 shillings was especially demoralizing. I mean, it was too painful and happened so suddenly. We could have dealt with any other price other than 1,000. It's so small. Around that time, the thieves had also become a menace. There was no way one could raise money to pay an armed guard when a kilo of vanilla sells for 1,000 shillings. Farmers gradually lost interest and left vanilla farms to die away.
The blow from vanilla has been hard and painful for Sekabira. These coffee plants are now thriving where vanilla used to grow. Coffee now occupies his 4-acre piece of land. He's been buying the seedlings and getting some from the government. But coffee is a less profitable enterprise, he says. A kilo sells for between 1,500 and 2,000 shillings. He still owes 3 million shillings in loans he took from Yuvan, a vanilla exporter, to expand his enterprise in 2003. He supplements coffee with bananas. These are majorly grown for home consumption and not as a commercial crop. For a farmer who used to lead in his community, this was a hard fall from grace.
I have never seen a crop as profitable as vanilla. It has so much monetary value. I cannot compare it to anything else. I'm growing coffee today, but I know pretty well that it will never match vanilla in value. We were so comfortable before the prices fell. Our children attended good schools. All I had to do as zone leader is to go to school managers and tell them to keep our children because their paycheck was guaranteed every harvesting season.
Half a kilometer from Sekabira's home, I've been invited to see another project that became a victim of the vanilla tragedy, Sande Lubega's dream house. In 2003, after getting 5 million from a single vanilla harvest, Lubega set out to build a permanent house. He was hoping to finish construction with the 2005 season's harvest, but that's when everything backfired. Vanilla prices fell, and so did his ambition. So in 2003, at the height of the vanilla season, Mr. Sande Lubega embarked on this rather ambitious project, a 3-bedroomed house. But just as he raced to complete it, the vanilla prices came crashing down, and this whole project has stalled since then. It's now an overgrown bush, and some parts of it have been falling apart, as you can see here.